Poor Quentin, who died, remember, on the Western Front, shot down by the Germans in July of 1918, Bastille Day, as a matter of fact. Poor Quinikins, as Theodore Roosevelt would often say to himself, mutter in unguarded moments. He, for the rest of his life, for the remaining 6 months left to him, was never really able to concentrate on anything. He was very much distracted. He could have run for president again in 1920. The odds are that he would have won, but his heart wasn't in it. And even if he had lived, I doubt he would have cared to make that race. The only real consolation, if it was a consolation that they had, was they got to know the woman who Quentin was going to marry. Quentin was engaged to Flora Payne Whitney at the time he was shot down by the Germans. And there's Flora Payne Whitney. She was the granddaughter of Cornelius Vanderbilt, the Commodore. And she was also, of course, had a lot of Whitney blood in her. Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney was her mother. And she was considered to be, in some ways, a little bit of a loose liver at the time by some rather unkind gossips. And they were a little bit unsure of her at first. But after Quentin died, she was completely broken up. And she shared that grief with Edith and got to know them based upon their shared grief. And that was a little bit of a consolation, even though she was never technically their daughter-in-law. But neither of them were ever going to be quite the same again. And it was no surprise to a lot of people when Theodore took ill shortly after the armistice in December of 1918. He had to go to the hospital. The doctor said it's probably an illness related to a parasite you picked up in Brazil, which probably was the case, but he just didn't have the strength to fight back. He was in the hospital for about a month. They finally sent him home at around Christmas time so he could go to Sagamore Hill. And he spent the new year there, and then on January 4th, after fading away a little bit and not showing much improvement, he died of an aneurysm in his sleep. And that resulted in his son Archie's famous telegram, the lion is dead. The lion is dead. Theodore Roosevelt, at long last, had died about the age of 60, I think. And it was said by more than one person that it was good that death had taken him in his sleep, because Theodore would have wrestled death to the ground if Theodore had been awake at the time. And so passed the remarkable Theodore Roosevelt, a man who showed once and for all what government could do if properly used, a man who once and for all put the White House in the presidency at the center of the action in Washington, and a man who would be the standard for much of the 20th century against which other presidents would be measured. There was never anybody like him, but one person who kind of wanted to be like him was his fifth cousin, Franklin. And we now turn to Franklin, who, unlike others, and 115,000 Americans never came back for the war, had a pretty good war as Assistant Secretary of the Navy. Now, one thing that Theodore Roosevelt didn't live to see, although he would have understood it if he had, was the results of World War I. He didn't live to see the Treaty of Versailles later in 1919. But the big winners of the war, probably in a world historical perspective, were the Japanese, who took the old German Empire in the Pacific under the rising sun. And among their other possessions, which nobody knew about in the United States in 1919, would be the Marianas, especially Saipan up there. Nobody knew what Saipan was in 1919, but every American would know Saipan within 30 years, of course. Eventually, the Marines and the Army would have to fight to take those islands. And this is how the Japanese originally got them, succeeding to the German Empire in the Pacific in World War I. One of Theodore's worst nightmares, a rising Japan threatening the Philippines, of course, was now about to come true. And we'll see that it was his fifth cousin, Franklin, who was going to have to address that. So the scene does shift to Franklin now, who, as Assistant Secretary of the Navy, had earned a national reputation, pretty good administrator. And in 1920, based upon his name and based upon his record, the Democrats decided to make him their vice presidential candidate in their race to take the White House in 1920. And here they are on campaign. That's Governor James Cox on the left, one of our eminently forgettable political nominees. There is Governor of Ohio. And there's Franklin, John T. Franklin, looking the way he usually did in photographs at the time, walking down the road in Dayton, Ohio, and campaigning in what everybody knew was a lost cause. No way the Democrats were going to win the 1920 race. These were sacrificial lambs more than anything. 1920 was a period of inflation, a period of strikes, a period of real national unease after the dislocations of the war. Most people were turning their backs on the Democrats, wanted nothing to do with the League of Nations, for example, and that would mean a big Republican year. Even Tammany Hall didn't really put much effort into this race. They cared about Al Smith becoming governor of New York, didn't care much about James Cox and Franklin Roosevelt, and so the whole thing was a foregone conclusion. But Franklin Roosevelt was not going to let anybody know that he knew that. He campaigned hard. He campaigned vigorously. He gave several speeches a day, shaking thousands of hands sometimes over the course of a week or 10 days, relaxing as much as he could on the train trips across the country that he had to take late at night with bourbon and poker with his close confidants before having to get up early in the morning and make yet another speech. But it was hopeless. In their desperation, the Democrats, toward the end of the campaign, tried one little trick that they thought might actually win them some votes, maybe give them a glimmer of a chance. And what they did was they spread a rumor that Warren G. Harding, the Republican nominee, had, quote, Negro blood. And they said that they looked into it. He had Negro blood. Warren Harding himself didn't really know. He said, you know, maybe. Actually, he said privately, that could be true. But the Republicans were so worried about this because the Democrats said it would be a national disgrace if he had a president with Negro blood. But the Republicans were so worried about it that they exhaustively traced Warren G. Harding's family tree to show, quote, that nobody in Ohio has a clearer record based upon blue-eyed stock from New England, the finest Anglo-Saxon blood. Well, so this Democratic attempt didn't work, and in a landslide victory, Warren G. Harding won the 1920 race. The Democrats only got 39% of the vote. It's one of the worst showings in their history, 39% of the vote. And the only bright spot in the whole thing was that the 19th Amendment had been ratified by then, and Eleanor got to cast the first vote of her life. That wasn't such a bad thing, but everything else about that race was pretty bad. And Franklin now found himself out of politics, which meant that he had to earn a living, and he decided to practice law in Manhattan. Had a pretty good job, as a matter of fact. He practiced law during the morning, and then during the afternoon, he had this job with an investment bank where mostly what he had to do was glad hand prospective investors and take them to lunch and stuff like that. And they were going to pay him $25,000 a year for that. So he was, you know, pretty happy about that in 1920, 1921. And he could do that for a while, think about politics later on, see how the winds would change, and more or less take things as they came. But then came 1921. And the Roosevelts, for a long time, going back to the 1880s, had this wonderful estate up on Campobello Island across the Passamaquoddy from Eastport, Maine, just in New Brunswick, just in Canada. And here's the Roosevelt Cottage, as they called it. That cottage is 34 rooms, 18 bedrooms, no electricity at the time, but 34 rooms. And every summer, Eleanor would pack up the children. They would go up there to Campobello. Packing up the children was no easy task. She always had to take between 50 and 55 trunks with her to get everything up there and get all the stuff they needed. I don't know how she ever did it. But 1921 was no exception, and Franklin would go up and spend some time there, go back to Manhattan, then go up. And then in August, he was looking forward to a whole month at Campobello with his family. So he left Manhattan August 5th. He's going to take a steamship up the coast to Campobello. And during the trip, he began to feel a little bit tired, which is a little bit uncharacteristic for him. I didn't know quite what it was. And on the seventh day, when he got there, he decided that he was going to do a little fishing. But he couldn't perform as well as he hoped because he did feel exhausted. He felt tired throughout the trip. And the next day, after he finally arrived, did a little bit more fishing. And while he was fishing, he fell into the Bay of Fundy, freezing cold waters of the Bay of Fundy. And it really came as a rude shock to him. And it just made him feel worse and worse. His legs started to ache by the first day he was back at Campobello. And they were still aching the next day. So he thought maybe the thing to do was to get some exercise. Maybe this was a little bit of funk he was in. Maybe he just needed some good solid exercise. So he led the kids on a race to this little pond where they'd like to swim. Raced to the pond, and then they were going to race back 2 miles in each direction. But it didn't help. It didn't help at all. He felt worse than ever when he got back to the cottage. And he felt that maybe it's something like lumbago. The first thing he put to himself was maybe this is lumbago. But that night, he found himself with a very high fever. He was shivering in a wool blanket, even though it was August at Campobello. And the next morning, when he woke up and got up to go to the bathroom, his leg buckled under him. and he could just barely drag himself to the bathroom, hoist himself up, and then go back. It was all he could do to do that. And that really began to get Eleanor worried, of course, when she heard about this. His temperature did nothing but rise. His legs got even worse. They felt worse. Eleanor and Louis Howe, his political confidant, kept massaging Franklin's legs in order to try to make them feel a little bit better, but nothing seemed to help. They called the local doctor. A local doctor came in from a little village in Canada, close by Campobello, and the doctor said, oh, it's just a cold, you'll get over it. Franklin knew good and well it wasn't just a cold. He couldn't go to the bathroom anymore. Actually, they needed to give him a catheter, as a matter of fact. This couldn't have been a cold. He knew it wasn't a cold, and nothing seemed to be helping. So 2 weeks went by, and he just seemed to get worse. And only after 2 weeks did a corps of doctors that they consulted, some of whom came up from New York, told him that more than likely it was poliomyelitis. That was the diagnosis. It has been suggested over the past 15 years that maybe it wasn't polio. Maybe it was actually Guillain-Barré syndrome. But the weight of the evidence is that it was just what those doctors said it was at the time. Weight of the evidence, it was probably polio. Now, polio has been around for thousands of years, but it only became something people in America knew much about in the 19th century. Some people called it paralysis of the morning, because typically it would strike you in the night and you feel very sick in the morning. That's often how people got sick with polio. Now, it's a virus, often enters the body through infected water, maybe infected with fecal matter that you come in contact with. And normally when you get the virus, you think you have a cold, just as Franklin did. And almost always it goes away. It goes away after a few days. But in some cases, the virus sticks around, and it attacks the nervous system, especially the spinal cord. Hence the name, poliomyelitis. Inflammation of the gray matter, polios is gray, inflammation of the gray matter of the spinal cord, which is amyelose. Now, there was reason to be terrified of polio in 1921 when Franklin now came down with it, because only 5 years before, in 1916, there had been a terrible polio epidemic in Manhattan. Thousands of children in New York City all of a sudden fell ill in late July and August of 1916, some of them suffering paralysis, unable to breathe, some of them dying with terrifying speed that summer. And no one knew what was causing it. The actual causes back then of polio were a bit mysterious. They wouldn't straighten that out for a while. So they figured it must be unclean conditions. So what they began to do as the kids began to get sick in New York is they cleansed the streets, and I'm sorry to say, they killed 70,000 stray cats. 70,000 stray cats in New York. Travelers were stopped at the city limits and checked out before they were allowed to go any further. They were given temporary transit passes to just pass through if they want, but they weren't allowed to spend much time there if there was any reason to think that they might be sick. People really were on the verge of panic. Anybody who got polio then, as would be the case for most of the 20th century, would be isolated completely for at least 2 months, wooden placards put on the front of the dwelling place, notifying people that a person with polio was within. And if you had any money, that summer in 1916, you sent your kids out of New York because you were so afraid they might get sick. 50,000 kids were sent out of the city to places like Hoboken and surrounding areas until some of those cities began not to take them anymore. Because they were getting filled up. Friends, relatives, how many of these kids could they actually take in? And many of the residents were very scared. Maybe these kids are bringing something with them. Who knew? So it was a time of real panic. But among those who didn't leave the city was a little 2-year-old kid who lived on 106th Street with his parents, Jonas Salk. Jonas Salk was there in 1916, and his family kept him where he was. And eventually, because of Franklin's illness, money would flow into polio research, and eventually Jonas Salk would take advantage of that to develop the famous vaccine. And for the next 50 years, as we all know, in the 20th century, the late summers, the height of the summer, would be the time of polio, the time of people very, very scared and anxious about children getting polio, where you would avoid the pools, you would avoid public parks, and where many families had the daily heartbreak of seeing their loved ones hitched up to an iron lung for days, weeks, months, maybe at a time, so they could somehow breathe, despite the paralysis that had set in because of that dread illness. The iron lung, by the way, was invented just down the road at Harvard. And the original iron lung cost as much as house did in the 1920s. So if you're going to have an iron lung at all, of course, I was going to be in a hospital. You're going to have to spend a great deal of time there. To this day, there's no cure for polio. And they knew there was no cure for polio in 1921 when Franklin got the diagnosis. So it was a terrible, terrible thing for him. And the question now was, how was he going to react? Well, for the rest of his life, Franklin Roosevelt, who you just saw in that picture with James Cox, look at this vitality. He always had that jauntiness about him. He emulated his fifth cousin as much as he could, tried to show the same kind of charisma and energy whenever he could. And that now was, at least in terms of walking on his own, unfortunately a thing of the past. Because now, if he was going to be walking, he was going to have to use leg braces. These are leg braces of his own design. He also designed a wheelchair. The wheelchairs of the time were rather bulky, large affairs, difficult to maneuver. He thought that was silly, and so he had his own chair, put wheels on it, and that was now going to be his wheelchair. But these were also the braces that he designed. And what that meant was that for the rest of his life, when he was wearing those braces, if he was going to get out of a chair and the braces would be on him, what he would have to do is reach down and pull the leg over the other leg like that, and then he would swivel over so he was facing the chair, and then use his arms to screw him on muscular as the years went by to brace himself against the back of the chair, and then he would push himself from the chair, keeping one arm on the chair so that he wouldn't just fall over backwards. And that is how he would get out of a chair. He didn't want people beyond the immediate family, beyond his friends, seeing him do that, but that's what he would have to do. And for the rest of his life, if he wanted to walk in public, normally he would need to be on the right arm of one of his sons or maybe a military aide. And he could hoist, he could make himself go on the braces along with somebody that he was holding on to with a unique swiveling movement of his hip. So the braces would propel him with the help of somebody that he was holding on to. And if he wanted to go upstairs, he would have to latch very hard to the railing, hoist himself up the stairs wherever he was. And then if he was going to go down the stairs, which of course he would have to do, he would pull one leg to the edge of a step, then jump down the step with the other leg, and then turn toward the wall, and then pull the original leg down to that level, and then he would repeat the process till he got down the stairs. Now he would walk with those braces as long as he could walk with those braces as long as he was resting on the arm of somebody, but it wasn't easy. It could be very painful for him, and his sons always testified to the fact that often Franklin would hold onto their arms so tight that it caused excruciating pain to his sons because he himself felt pain trying to walk forward on the braces, even with the help of one of his sons that he was holding on to. And that would be, for the next 24 years, Franklin's life with polio. And I always think, in regard to this tragedy that had now befallen Franklin and his family, that in emulating Theodore and trying to live up to the immense reputation that Theodore had made for himself and the family, that Roosevelt, in this process, exceeded Theodore. Theodore Roosevelt was a very brave man. But it's nothing like this kind of bravery that Franklin would have to show for the next 24 years. Every single day, dealing with the scourge of polio and trying to convey to people around him an air of confidence and happiness, despite the discouragement he must have felt all the time. There's a certain bravery there that's of a far, far higher order than facing Mauser rifle bullets, it seems to me. And he was in the public eye for most of that time. This is courage of a very, very, very high order. And what got him through were several things. He had certain confidence that was always in him. His mother certainly helped. His family helped a lot. But one thing that people forget is that Roosevelt said that the thing that saved his life, or one of the things that saved his life, was this. He was, as most people know, a stamp collector. And he inherited his love of stamp collecting from his mother, Sarah, who was also a stamp collector. Franklin started collecting stamps at the age of 8. And what he liked to do was he put stamps some strange places in the album. And then he would look things up in the encyclopedia about those countries and about the people on the stamps. And he would annotate his stamp album. And that's how he taught himself history and geography and politics and matters like that. Not just school, not just Groton, but also his stamp collection. He adored collecting stamps. And what happened after he got to be president was that he made sure that he oversaw the design for all 200 stamps that came out from the United States during his time in the White House. So sometimes he would actually design the stamps, but he would always okay the design or reject them. He also, and it's no accident, as part of the WPA, made sure that there were 400 brand new post offices built all across the United States. None of that was an accident. And eventually he had 1.2 million stamps. And these stamps here were part of Franklin Roosevelt's collection. But he often said that even though he couldn't walk and run anymore, he could at least enjoy his stamp collection. And in those hours that he spent with his stamps were crucial to him as he began to learn how to live with himself, now with polio, beginning in 1921. And for the rest of his life, until the very end, he took his stamps with him wherever he went. He had this wooden box where part of his stamp collection was. He took it to Yalta, he took it to Casablanca, but he forgot it on the last trip of his life to Warm Springs. He left it back in Washington, so the stamps weren't with him when he finally met his end in April of 1945. So we're going to begin here with Warm Springs. Warm Springs was the foundation that he established. He always felt that hydrotherapy might actually help his withered legs, and so he often went to Warm Springs and thought very highly of it, and that's where we're going to start here as we lead up to his election of governor of New York and eventually to the presidency. But everybody, it wasn't concealed that he had polio. People knew he had polio, of course, and so he was often written letters by fellow sufferers, kids with polio especially, and he would always make sure he dictated a response to Missy LaHand or Grace Tully so that they would get a letter back from the president. And I want to read now a letter he got from a teenager who had polio. And this was a teenager in Ohio, and it's 1936, and the teenager said that he's getting discouraged, he's getting unhappy, and this is what the letter said. "The trouble is," wrote this young man, "I am so far from home," he's in the hospital, "and no one comes to visit me, while all the others in the ward get visitors. And so here it is, would a busy man like you spare the time to drop me a line? I know it is a lot to ask, but it would help a lot, and I don't know where else to turn." It's February 1936, and Roosevelt dictated a letter, and he said, "I can tell from your letter that you do have the courage to hang in there, and I want you to know that it meant a lot to me that you would write me so I could let you know that." So not only was there courage here, but there was also a new kind of wisdom that maybe his fifth cousin never quite had, a wisdom that comes from knowing what privation and suffering really were, and to see that in others and to empathize with it. So now what we're going to do is we're going to go to Warm Springs for a little while. We kind of begin in an awkward place here, but you'll see that it all begins to make sense, I hope. Let's see. And then we'll get to the election of 1928 with the governorship of New York. Whoops, that wasn't the right thing to do. There. See the leg braces.
The hotel never did work out. Prospective guests were scared off by the presence of polio patients. Roosevelt would never make any money and eventually turned Warm Springs into a foundation. But Eleanor was wrong. He never lost interest.
Oh, thank you.
Backed away.
So it slowly became the nation's premier rehabilitation center for polios. And Roosevelt became almost obsessed with raising money for it and helping people. For him personally, it was all kinds of things. It was the first project that he had ever had, which he absolutely ran on his own.
Thank you.
He worked in the Navy Department as an assistant secretary, which deeply troubled him. This was his creation.
Well, he went to meetings.
And it allowed him to be unselfconscious about polio. It's hard to convey, especially a person who was as beautiful as Franklin Roosevelt had been, that he suddenly had withered legs. I don't care how magnetic and self-confident you are or think you are, to know that people are staring at them is something that you never really get over. And at Warm Springs, he could not wear his braces and go to the swimming pool and have everybody see how small his legs were, and it didn't bother him because there were people there with worse problems.
You would howl with glee if you could see the clinic in operation at the side of the pool and the patients doing various exercises in the water under my leadership. They are male and female of all ages and weights. In addition to all this, I am consulting architect and landscape engineer and giving free advice on the moving of buildings, the building of roads, setting out trees, and remodeling the hotel.
He was the sort of king of Warm Springs. He knew everybody in town, and he loved being one of them and being the number one of them at the same time. And that was all his life and everything he did. He loved to be surrounded by people, all of whom knew that he was number one.
Warm Springs was the first project he had ever undertaken, meant largely to benefit others. He began to call himself Old Dr. Roosevelt. He devised pioneering water exercises, hired physiotherapists to work with him and his fellow patients in the pool, and paid local push boys to wheel them to and from the water.
Well, we got them up in the morning, bathed, dressed them, fed them, and take them to wherever they had to go. They were going to the therapy, we had to take them to the therapy room. They were going to the pool, we had to load them on old makeshift bus and take them down the hill. There was lots of fun, you know, pool play and stuff like that, because he liked to get in there with the patients. And he ducked if you got in that pool. You got within reach, he ducked you with your window cover. Anyway, he had to go in the water. But he was shy.
And he was standing at the door. He was shaking hands with all the patients that came that day. We all had nicknames, and when he met me, he said, "Little girl, what is your name?" I told him, "Suzanne." "I love that name, Suzanne, but I'd like to call you Susie. Is that all right?" And I said, "Uh-huh." And guess what we called him? Rosie. And when we called him Rosie, it was always when he drove up in front of Georgia Hall. We would be out there, hey Rosie, and he loved it.
Doc Roosevelt's prescription called for sunshine, swimming, gentle exercise and massage, and above all, belief on the patient's part that the muscles are coming back. The physical progress he and the others made may have been minimal, but their psychological progress was beyond measure.
Oh, he was always happy, and he gave the impression that it just made you want to achieve everything you could and to be more like than he was. And if we saw him do it, we wanted to do it. The only thing that I had a big problem with, those ovary steps that had four different sides to it, you would learn how to go up and down them. And I didn't want to try. But when I saw the rest of them doing it, and he was down there watching, I wasn't about to give up. I'm going to try. And
to see someone so famous, who suffered from exactly the same problems that you suffered from, meant an enormous amount to all of the people that went there. Most of the people who went there really out of despair, at least at first. They couldn't, there wasn't any other place to go. And here was this laughing giant who would kid them and would make the kind of awful, sick jokes about being handicapped that other handicapped people love, but that you can't share with anybody else. He loved doing that.
He declared himself vice president in charge of picnics. His favorite spot was a rocky overhang called Dowell's Knob. Whenever a patient seemed about to give in to despair, he once told a friend, he or she should be brought to Dowell's Knob right away. One look at the glorious view, he believed, would provide the will to go on. Eleanor now had a place of her own as well, a symbol of her growing autonomy. Back in 1924, Franklin, Eleanor, Nancy Cook, and Marion Dickerman had spread a picnic blanket on the shore of a meandering stream on Roosevelt land, 2 miles east of Springwood. Springwood was always closed for the winter, and they all agreed it was a shame Hyde Park wasn't available to them all year round. Franklin volunteered to build Eleanor and her friends a stone cottage of their own. My missus and some of her female political friends want to build a shack on a stream in the backwoods, he wrote a local contractor. It took a little over a year and a half to complete, and would eventually include a small furniture factory in an adjacent building, employing local craftsmen and overseen by Nancy Cook. For a time, Eleanor, Cook, and Dickerman all lived in a single dormitory room, in an atmosphere reminiscent of Allenswood, the English boarding school that had meant so much to her as a girl. The peace of it, Eleanor said, is divine. Once the Valkill cottage was completed, Eleanor rarely slept at Springwood again, unless Franklin happened to be there.
Actually, FDR is relieved that Eleanor Roosevelt has a new community, and they begin to create not only two separate courts, but two separate lives. And they meet for all the reasons they need to meet to promote political things that they're going to promote together, including FDR's career. But it's really a question of parallel lives at this point.
If women believe they have a right and duty in political life today, they must learn to talk the language of men. Against the men bosses, there must be women bosses who can talk as equals.
In the mid-1920s, Eleanor Roosevelt became something of a boss herself, and used her clout on behalf of progressive causes on which most of her male counterparts preferred to waffle. The League of Nations, the 5-day work week, an amendment to end child labor. She even got herself arrested, walking a picket line in support of striking box workers. And because of the tragedies caused by alcohol within her own family, she also publicly supported prohibition, even though her husband was silent on the subject and maintained ready supplies of gin and rum and scotch at Warm Springs and in an upstairs closet in their New York home. Eleanor's new and independent life meant that she had less time for her children. They were alternately ignored and indulged. One by one, she would dutifully escort James and Elliot, Franklin Jr. and John to Groton. And she continued to clash again and again with her mother-in-law, who spoiled all her grandchildren and sometimes murmured to them that she was their real mother. Eleanor had only borne them. Anna, the eldest, may have suffered most from the ongoing tensions within her family. She adored her absent father, but also sympathized with her mother, who, while Anna was still in her teens, confirmed to her the rumors she had heard about her father's romance with Lucy Mercer. She was forced by her mother and grandmother into making a formal debut at 18 and failed to go to college, in part because her grandmother believed educated women scared off suitors. Barely 20, she married Curtis Dahl, a Wall Street broker 10 years older than she. Many years later, explaining her early marriage, she said she'd simply wanted to get out, away from the complications that continued to divide her family. In the spring of 1928, Al Smith was the frontrunner for the Democratic nomination for president and asked Franklin to nominate him again at the upcoming convention in Houston. I'm telling everyone you are going to Houston without crutches, Eleanor wrote Franklin at Warm Springs. So mind you, stick at it. This time, he needed no urging. to demonstrate to the delegates that he was making progress toward becoming a potential candidate in his own right. He knew he had to be able to walk, or seem to walk, on his own. For weeks at Warm Springs, he labored at mastering what his physiotherapists called a two-point walk, the slow, rocking gait he would employ in public for the rest of his life.
His whole leg would be put forward, and then the other side would be put forward, and the other side would be put forward. It was painful, it was very slow, and it was very precarious. If he got jostled, if the wind blew too hard, if one of his bodyguards forgot or relaxed, he could go to the ground. So he was in constant fear that that was going to happen.
At the Houston convention, he used his new technique to make his way to the podium. Thousands of onlookers stood again to cheer his progress. And now he was strong enough to use one hand to acknowledge their applause. Smith won the nomination, and then, to Roosevelt's astonishment, insisted that he run for governor of New York in his place. Louis Howe thought it madness. Republicans and their candidate, Herbert Hoover, were riding a tide of prosperity in 1928. Smith's Catholicism and open opposition to prohibition made a Democratic victory still more unlikely. Eleanor, already committed to heading Democratic women's work for Smith's candidacy, felt that if her husband ran and somehow won, it might mean for her the loss of the separate and fulfilling life she'd worked so hard to build. And Missy Lehan told Franklin, "Don't you dare run." She didn't want to give him up to public life either. Roosevelt himself was torn, even ducked Smith's calls for a time. But in the end, he gave in and agreed to run for governor. "When you're in politics," he told a friend, "you've got to play the game." Republican newspapers denounced Smith for persuading what they called a crippled man to run. "It was a pathetic and pitiless act," one said. Privately, Smith thought Franklin was little more than an invalid. "He won't live a year," he told a friend. But he assured the press, "A governor doesn't have to be an acrobat. We do not elect him for his ability to do a double backflip." To demonstrate he was up to the job, Roosevelt campaigned through every one of New York's 62 counties, something no candidate for governor had ever done before. He did all he could to minimize the impact of his disability on the voters. "No movies of me getting out of the machine, boys," he'd shout to the newsreel cameraman as he arrived for a speech, and they obliged. On election night, Franklin, Eleanor, and Sarah waited for the returns at Democratic headquarters at the Biltmore Hotel in Manhattan. It was quickly clear that Al Smith and the Democrats had suffered a terrible defeat. Smith carried only 7 states. Even his own state of New York went to Herbert Hoover. Franklin and Eleanor left for home well before midnight, convinced Franklin's candidacy had also failed, even though all the returns were not yet in. But Sarah Delano Roosevelt stayed put. By 4 o'clock in the morning, Franklin was going to win a narrow victory. A friend called room service, and because of prohibition, ordered milk, not champagne, with which to toast her son's surprising triumph. FDR would occupy still another of the offices his cousin Theodore had held on his way to the presidency. Al Smith had assumed Franklin would be a mostly absentee governor, allowing him somehow to retain power through the men and women he'd appointed to state office. He was quickly disabused of that notion. FDR fired Smith's 2 closest aides. "I've got to be the governor of the state of New York," he told a friend, "and I have got to be it myself." Al Smith would never forgive him. The morning after the election, a reporter had asked Eleanor if she were excited by her husband's triumph. No, she answered. If the rest of the ticket didn't get in, what does it matter?
I felt Governor Smith's election as president might have meant something. But whether Franklin spends 2 years in Albany or not matters comparatively little. It will have pleasant and unpleasant sides for him, and the good to the state is problematical. Crowds, newspapers, etc. mean so little, it does not even stir me.
As the First Lady of New York, she reluctantly resigned her political and lobbying posts. But she refused to give up the job that meant the most to her, teaching American history and 19th century literature 3 days a week at the Todd Hunter School for Girls in Manhattan. It gave her an opportunity to instill in her students some of the qualities her own beloved schoolmistress, Mademoiselle Souvestre, had instilled in her. Open-mindedness, independent thinking, social consciousness. I teach because I love it, she explained. I cannot give it up. She organized the household in Albany, assigning Missy LaHand a bedroom larger than hers, found space for her circle of friends as well as Franklin's, and toured prisons and hospitals on her husband's behalf, remembering his exhortation to lift the lids on cooking pots, to check whether people were getting the quality of food they were supposed to get. And she sometimes stood in for him at political events as well.
Dear Franklin, arrived at the Staten Island Democratic Lunch 12:30. Stood and shook hands till 1:30. Ate till 3:30. Talked till 5:20. Home here at 6:40. Nearly dead. You are the finest governor ever. And I have all the virtues and would gladly have dispensed with half of them could I have left at 4.
Soon after becoming governor, Franklin ordered that wherever Eleanor went, she be accompanied by Corporal Earl Miller of the New York State Police, who would serve as her bodyguard.
He's not just her driver and her guard, he's her buddy. He teaches her how to shoot a pistol, how to shoot a rifle without breaking your shoulder. He teaches her how to dive. He is her great friend. And they spend hours and hours together. She has a lot of fun with Earl Miller.
He was handsome, high-spirited, and devoted. Eleanor was flattered by his attention and pleased to be asked for advice about his many girlfriends. Miller became a member of her closest circle, even starred with her in a homemade parody of a Douglas Fairbanks movie, filmed at Val Kill by Marion Dickerman.
The New York Times, October 25th, 1929. The most disastrous decline in the biggest and broadest stock market of history rocked the financial district yesterday. It carried down with it speculators, big and little, in every part of the country. Losses were tremendous, and thousands of prosperous brokerage and bank accounts, sound and healthy a week ago, were completely wrecked in the strange debacle due to a combination of circumstances, but accelerated into a crash by fear.
Americans had survived panics before, but they had experienced nothing remotely like the Great Depression that began with the stock market crash in the autumn of 1929. Within 12 months, the number of jobless more than doubled. Within another year, it would double again with no recovery in sight. Kansas farmers burned their wheat to keep warm. Kentucky coal miners survived on pokeweed and dandelion greens. 10 Pennsylvania convicts out on parole asked to be locked up again. Life beyond prison walls was too hard. Everyone seemed to feel the effects. In Manhattan, Franklin Roosevelt's own son-in-law, Curtis Dahl, lost his job and his home in Westchester County and had to move with Anna and FDR's first two grandchildren into the Roosevelt House on East 65th Street. Just a few blocks to the west, homeless men built tar paper shacks in the heart of Central Park. They had nowhere else to go. Like hundreds of thousands of desperate people all across the country, they named their temporary village Hooverville, after the president whom they had come to blame for everything that had happened to them. Americans differed over what caused the Depression and what should be done about it. But Herbert Hoover's grim personality and his repeated unconvincing promises that recovery was just months away combined to persuade a growing majority of Americans that a change was needed. Meanwhile, Franklin Roosevelt took more bold action than any of his fellow governors. He championed public power, put unemployed men to work on state conservation projects, created the Temporary Emergency Relief Administration, the first state agency in the country to provide public relief for the unemployed. Not as a matter of public charity, he said, but as a matter of social duty. In the final analysis, he declared, the progress of our civilization will be retarded if any large body of citizens falls behind. Without the help of thousands of others, any one of us would die naked and starved. In 1930, Roosevelt was re-elected governor by almost 750,000 votes. I do not see how Mr. Roosevelt can escape becoming the next presidential nominee of his party, the state Democratic chairman told the press, even if no one should raise a finger to bring it about. Even Ted Roosevelt reluctantly agreed. Well, as far as I can see, the Republican ship went down with all on board, he wrote his mother. Cousin Franklin now, I suppose, will run for the presidency, and I'm already beginning to think of nasty things to say concerning them. The most serious hindrance to FDR's winning the nomination were persistent rumors about his health. People whispered that infantile paralysis had affected his mind, even that he was actually suffering from syphilis. To offset them, Roosevelt secretly paid a freelance journalist named Earl Looker to, quote, challenge him to prove his fitness for office and write up the results in Liberty magazine. Then, also behind the scenes, Roosevelt provided the money to pay three leading diagnosticians to look him over. The examination itself was legitimate. All three doctors signed a statement pronouncing Roosevelt in fine shape, aside from the after effects of polio. Though one of them, an implacable Republican, privately told his colleagues he wanted it understood that, so far as I'm concerned, this doesn't go for above the neck.
July 16th, 1931. Well, sir, we got away with the Liberty article despite all obstacles. I think we can be sure that at least 7.5 million readers are sure you are physically fit. Earl Looker.
FDR would never again feel the need to speak in detail about his health to any journalist. As the 1932 Democratic Convention opened in Chicago, Roosevelt was the clear frontrunner, with a reputation as one of the most activist and effective governors in the country.
I call on you, whose standards I see before me, to hear and now testify to your determination that the candidate of this convention shall be and must be that incarnation of Thomas Jefferson, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, New York.
Yeah. Still, he had 9 rivals, including his embittered old ally, Al Smith, and the conservative Speaker of the House, John Nance Garner of Texas. It took 4 ballots and the second place on the ticket for Garner for Roosevelt to win the nomination. Custom still required the candidate to wait weeks to be formally notified of his nomination.
We have a perfect day for this trip, and I'm very happy to be going out to Chicago, and everybody knows the reason why I'm so happy.
In an electrifying break with that tradition, FDR decided to fly from Albany to Chicago to accept the nomination right away. Louis Howe handed him his speech.
My friends of the Democratic National Convention of 1932, I appreciate your willingness after these 6 arduous days to remain here. For I know well the sleepless hours which you and I have had. The appearance before a national convention of its nominee for president to be formally notified of his selection is unprecedented and unusual. But these are unprecedented and unusual times.
29 years earlier, Theodore Roosevelt had promised the American people a square deal. Now, 11 years after polio seemed to have crushed his political hopes, Franklin Roosevelt made a promise of his own.
On the farm, in the large metropolitan areas, in the smaller cities and in the villages, millions of our citizens cherish the hope that their old standards of living and of thought have not gone forever. Those millions cannot and shall not hope in vain. I pledge myself to a new deal for the American people.
President Hoover had grown so unpopular that one of Roosevelt's defeated rivals for the nomination told FDR all he had to do to win was to stay alive till November. With the Depression deepening, a double line of policemen armed with rifles now ringed the U.S. Capitol to keep out demonstrators. When 17,000 mostly jobless veterans of the Great War and their families descended on Washington to demand an immediate payment of a bonus they'd been promised, Hoover called out the Army. The veterans were brutally driven from the Capitol. Roosevelt told an aide, "This will elect me." Still, he took no chances. Roosevelt campaigned hard all across the country, promising help for the forgotten man at the bottom of the economic pyramid, attacking Hoover for inaction, and simultaneously pledging to slash the federal budget by 25%. Hoover denounced him as a chameleon on plaid. Spoke of Roosevelt, they meant Franklin, not Theodore. The Oyster Bay Roosevelts have become the out-of-season Roosevelts, a friend wrote. Theodore Roosevelt's younger sister, Corinne, would cross party lines to vote for FDR that fall. But Alice Roosevelt Longworth, TR's eldest daughter, campaigned hard against him aboard President Hoover's train.
There we were, the Roosevelts. Hubris up to the eyebrows, beyond the eyebrows. And then who should come sailing down the river but Nemesis, in the person of Cousin Franklin.
And at Sagamore Hill, Theodore Roosevelt's widow, Edith, was so infuriated at receiving some 300 congratulatory messages from people who mistakenly thought Franklin was one of her sons that she made an unprecedented appearance at a Republican rally in Manhattan to introduce the Republican incumbent, just to make it clear that this Oyster Bay Roosevelt would also be voting for Herbert Hoover. Someone once asked Sarah Delano Roosevelt why so many of the Roosevelts of Oyster Bay seemed so hostile to her branch of the family. She didn't know, she said, but perhaps it's because we're so much better looking.
Sitting down here next to me is Mrs. Roosevelt, my wife, and my granddaughter, Anna Roosevelt Dow, on her lap. What's our campaign slogan, Sissick?
Happy days are here again.
Good, that's right.
On election night, November 8th, 1932, Franklin Delano Roosevelt won the presidency of the United States of America by 7 million votes and carried 42 of the 48 states. His party took control of both houses of Congress. It was the greatest Democratic victory in more than three quarters of a century. In the Philippines, where Theodore Roosevelt Jr. was serving as Governor General, he identified himself to a reporter as the President-elect's fifth cousin, about to be removed.
I was happy for him, of course, because I knew that in many ways it would make up for the blow that fate had dealt him. But for myself, I was deeply troubled, as I saw it. This meant the end of any personal life of my own. I had watched Mrs. Theodore Roosevelt and had seen what it meant to be the wife of the president. The turmoil in my heart was rather great that night, and the next few months were not to make any clearer what the road ahead would be.
During the four long months between Roosevelt's election and his inauguration, the Depression got still worse. Stocks, bonds, farm prices, everything continued to spiral downward. Anxious depositors withdrew their savings in frenzied runs on banks. Nearly 400 of them failed in January and February alone. President Hoover called repeatedly upon the president-elect to join him in what he called cooperative action to end the crisis. Roosevelt refused, wary of being trapped into supporting orthodox policies of which he did not approve. Off the record, the president-elect told a reporter, "The country's troubles were not yet my baby." FDR visited Hyde Park, rested at Warm Springs, then went to sea for 12 days, fishing in the Caribbean and sleeping aboard a palatial yacht owned by an old Hudson River friend, Vincent Astor. Whoa.
I got this idea when I was 17 years old. I see a lot of things I see in my mind. I see a lot of poor people are hungry for a piece of bread. People want bread, don't have bread to eat. In my mind, the idea is to kill the president in one country. After he is killed, kill another, and then kill another. Giuseppe Zangara.
The president-elect's fishing trip ended at Miami, Florida, on the evening of February 15, 1933. Roosevelt stopped his car to speak to the crowd that had gathered to see him. A deranged Italian immigrant named Giuseppe Zangara was waiting with a revolver. He hated all presidents, he said later, and everybody who is rich. He had hoped to shoot Hoover. Now he wanted to kill Roosevelt. He got off five shots and hit five bystanders, including the mayor of Chicago, who happened to be standing next to the president-elect. FDR never flinched. He refused to take cover, ordered the Secret Service to lift the mortally wounded mayor into his car, held onto him during the race to the hospital. Eleanor was in New York. Franklin called to reassure her. "He's all right," she said afterwards. "He's not the least bit excited. These things are to be expected." Like Theodore Roosevelt, nearly 21 years earlier, Franklin seemed unaffected by coming so close to death. There was nothing an aide who spent that evening with him remembered, not so much as the twitching of a muscle, the mopping of a brow, or even the hint of a false gaiety to indicate that it wasn't any evening in any other place. "I have never seen anything in my life more magnificent." At his inauguration 17 days later, gripping James's arm, Roosevelt would demonstrate another kind of courage. In 40 of the 48 states, all the banks were closed. The stock exchange suspended trading. Industrial production had been cut almost in half. Nearly half of all American farmers faced foreclosure. Almost one out of three wage earners, some 14 million men and women, was without work. When their families were included, at least 40 million people had no dependable source of income.
"Do you, Franklin Delano Roosevelt, do solemnly swear?"
It was very, very solemn and a little terrifying. You felt people would do anything if only someone would tell them what to do. One has the feeling of going in blindly because we're in a tremendous stream and none of us know where we're going to land.
"Preserve, protect, and defend the Constitution of the United States, so help me God."
Americans everywhere were waiting to hear what the new president had to say.
"I shall ask the Congress for the one remaining instrument."
He would promise bold action and call upon Congress to grant him broad executive powers to wage a war against the emergency.
"As great as the power that would be given to me if we were in fact invaded by a foreign foe."
action, and action now.
But it was another line his frightened fellow citizens remembered best. It echoed hard-earned lessons that had informed the lives of first Theodore and then Eleanor Roosevelt, and now informed his life as well.
So first of all, let me assert my firm belief that the only thing we have to fear is fear itself. Nameless, unreasoning, unjustified terror, which paralyzes needed effort to convert retreat into advance. In every dark hour of our...
The only thing we have to fear is fear itself. In some ways, it's inspired nonsense. If you're worried about putting food on the table, that's something real to fear. That's not fear itself. And yet, like all great works of fiction, all great stories, that line captures the willing suspension of disbelief that makes anything possible. And somebody watching the speech, Tommy Corcoran, who later went to work for Roosevelt, said that the moment was like Excalibur being pulled from the stone, and that you just had a sense, this guy can do it. He can lift us up.
Okay. So we can take a break and get some coffee and some brownies. I want to say a few words about the Happy Warrior, Al Smith, when you come back. But why don't we take a short break now, and then I'll just have a few words to wrap up in a minute. Out of New York. His name was actually Ferraro when he was born. Everybody knows he was Irish, but people forget that he was half Italian. So he was born with the name Ferraro, which is Italian for blacksmith, so he changed his name to Smith, that L. Smith. That's how he got to have that name. And he all his life had a pretty thick New York accent, which was not going to help him when he ran for president in 1928, because he'd go on the radio to try to address the country and maybe round up some votes on the radio. And one problem he had was he was very fidgety, and he kept kind of rocking around, so his voice would go in and out on the radio, kind of in and out like that, because he could never actually get close to the microphone for as long as he needed to. But the worst thing was his accent. When he said first, he said foist. And it was a bit off-putting to a lot of people around the country. And it didn't make anything any better when his campaign song was Sidewalks of New York. It's not going to go well in Missouri and Nebraska. So he had several strikes against him when he undertook the task of trying to become president with a Democratic nomination of 1928. But there's a lot to admire about him. He was a very smart guy. He knew a lot, even though he'd never been to college. He always said that he got his FFM degree. It says for Fulton Fish Market, the FFM degree. But what really did him in, even though probably no Democrat was going to win in 1928, but what really did him in, of course, was he was a Catholic. And he was the first major party Catholic nominee. And rumors were spread by many people who thought it would be a catastrophe that a Catholic would ever be in the White House, that if he should be elected, among other things, all Protestant marriages would be annulled. Pastors actually spread that from their pulpits. So if you vote for Smith, eventually your marriages will be no good. They'll be annulled. The rumor was spread that Smith had managed to build an extension of the Holland Tunnel to Rome. So the Pope will be able to get there under the Atlantic, if need be. And these were actually taken seriously, these rumors. They surveyed 8,000 Methodist ministers. Who are you going to vote for? 8,000 Methodist ministers. A grand total of 4 said L. Smith. 4 of them said they'd vote for L. Smith. And in fact, when L. Smith's train went through the western states on the way to California, there were places where he could look out the window and he could see burning crosses of the Ku Klux Klan just waiting for him, because they knew that's where the train was going to go. And it would, of course, take till 1960 before we were going to elect a Catholic president. But this anti-Catholic prejudice was very, very, very bad for L. Smith. There's not much he could do about it. But one idea he had was to try to bring out Babe Ruth to campaign for him. So at one point he did have Babe Ruth on the campaign train, but that didn't go well at all, because when he'd bring Babe Ruth out to say something to the crowd, the babe would often be in a t-shirt, and he'd have some beer in his hand. which is during Prohibition, maybe you shouldn't be doing that. And they said that's enough. You've probably done enough. Al Smith hated Prohibition. Al Smith would openly serve alcohol at the governor's mansion in New York, even during Prohibition. He was a famous wet, somebody who really wanted to do away with it, even though Franklin never was considered a wet. Certainly Al Smith was. But it's true that Al Smith never forgave Franklin Roosevelt for machinations leading up to the 1932 convention. And Al Smith did go into opposition, became much more conservative than he used to be, especially during the New Deal, really disapproved of the New Deal, even though he'd been a very progressive governor during his gubernatorial days. But that's the happy warrior, Al Smith. And we also saw Ted Roosevelt. I forgot to mention that Ted Roosevelt was, of course, Assistant Secretary of the Navy. So Theodore was, Franklin was, and under Harding, Ted Roosevelt was, among many other offices that he held. And then we left, of course, during the height of the Great Depression. It's now 1933, catastrophic bank failures across the country. There were 25,000 banks in America in 1933. 11,000 of them have shut their doors. 11,000 of the 25,000 were gone, most of them gone for good. And the question was, can we save the rest of them? And nobody knew if they could save the rest of them in March of 1933. And that's why this was really the biggest crisis we'd faced since Fort Sumter. Those would be the two circumstances in which presidents came in literally knowing they had to save the country and wondering what on earth they were going to do. If the banks go, what's left? There's no banks. What's left? And we'll see what happened after that when I see you next after March of 1933. But this was not going to be easy. And the story of how the banks were saved and ultimately how the worst of the Great Depression lifted, it's a complicated one, but we'll try to tell a little bit of it when I see you next. Because we did a whole series on the Depression, whole series on World War II in here, so we can summarize a little of it next time in this short space we have. But anybody have any questions? Go ahead, comment, go ahead.
I once read that during World War II, the most of 4Fs were young men who were malnourished from the Depression.
Mm-hmm.
That was the main reason for, 4F. They were so malnourished during the Depression that by the time the war came, they just couldn't pass a physical.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one thing about the Depression, and I've talked about this a little bit before, but one good thing about the Depression was that there was so much unused industrial capacity, because it took so long to get people back to work again, that when World War II happened, we had all this unused capacity that we could more easily shift into military production. So if we'd entered World War II prosperous, it might have been harder to do that, retool all that factory apparatus to producing tanks and planes. But there was all there, much of it unused, so it could much more easily be retooled that way. And you had a whole generation of young men who were accustomed to privation and hunger and hardship. And the war is going to see a lot of privation and hunger and hardship, that's for sure. Yeah, back there, yes.
What were the causes of the animosity between Teddy Roosevelt's family and Franklin? Was it purely politics, or was there something personal also involved?
Well, it's partly politics. They were very different kinds of progressives, the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. But it was also personal, because Alice and most people on the Oyster Bay side of the Roosevelt family thought that the right successor to the White House would be Ted, that Ted should be the one who would go on to be president. And they didn't approve of Franklin being that choice. So there was some jealousy about that, certainly.
She had a mouth.
She had a mouth. Alice called Franklin Miss Nancy. That was her nickname for Franklin, Miss Nancy. Not nice.
Didn't she say she would rather vote for Hitler in 1940? She did say that.
Yeah, she probably did say something like that. Yeah.
You just said that damn woman.
Yeah, she could be cruel, Alice, certainly. She knew about Franklin's affair with Lucy Mercer when that was not public knowledge. Eleanor knew eventually, of course, but Alice knew. And Alice approved of it. Alice didn't like Eleanor very much. So they put aside their grievances towards the end when Eleanor, I think I mentioned this before, wrote a very nice touching letter to Alice commiserating with her over the death of Alice's child. And the two of them did grow closer eventually in the 50s, but it would take a while. Yeah, go ahead.
What about Warm Springs? I think I read that it was a very rundown place when Roosevelt bought it, and Eleanor never liked going down there.
No. No, she didn't. She usually didn't go down there, but Franklin would. It was a rundown place. It had been a spa that never really made any money. And Franklin found out about it, bought it, and made it into what it was. And he would also help preside over the March of Dimes. Eddie Cantor gave that organization the name, the March of Dimes, which of course is why Roosevelt's picture is on the dime, owing to his work with polio. Yeah, go ahead, yeah.
Yeah, I was wondering, I've never seen any woman or child in a bread line of all the photographs. Were they taken care of separately somehow?
Oh, well, I don't know, but that's a good point. I never thought about that. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Churches, yeah, probably. I don't know if they were left home with family members, as somebody had to stand on the line, but maybe didn't have to be the entire family, just as long as somebody was there. But I don't know.
The bowl was there eating, and not stuff to take home. So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's
could have been a separate one.
That's true. Could be. Could well be.
What did he say in here?
Well, you talk about Pine Hill.
Roses.
Yeah.
So they're single sex.
Yeah. Speaking of dimes, you all know the famous joke about Hoover in 1932. Hoover, according to the joke, went to somebody and said, can you give me a nickel? I have to call my friend. And the person said, here's a dime, call both of them. Speaking of dimes. Yeah. Yeah. Which is not really fair. Poor Hoover.
It's kind of eerie how this is so almost current.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of stuff about the politics that seems to be happening in our now current politics.
And I think a close approximation is the 1912 election, when you had the Republican split, like which might happen today with the Republican Party, with Trump, maybe, and then could be a broker convention where there's a regular choice. Maybe Trump runs on his own. Who knows if he doesn't feel he's a bit treated fairly. So it would be like a split Republican Party today like there was in 1912. And maybe then.
But the crowds cheering and the guy that shot him, and there's a lot of, just seems almost eerie that could be happening today.
Mm-hmm. Well, those are genuine crisis times. And I know in Atlanta, it was so bad that the city literally had no money, no cash. And I was thinking about this looking at Warm Springs. There's no money to pay the teachers. So what were the teachers going to do? They were going to shut down the public schools. So what Atlanta did was they issued scrip, which some cities did during the Great Depression, their own private money, City of Atlanta money, pay the teachers in scrip. But what they would do is they would say, you can use the scrip at Rich's department store in downtown Atlanta. And Rich's would then give store credit or cash in return for the scrip. And the teachers never forgot Rich's department store. And for the rest of their lives, they would always go to Rich's. And if they had to go to another department store, they'd feel guilty about it. Sometimes they send substitutes, just so nobody sees us going to this. They love Rich's so much. But people, if you could find a way like that to make do, and if somebody would come to your aid like that, it would foster a kind of loyalty that you never forgot. Really, really hard times can sometimes bring out the best in people, and sometimes the best in institutions. Yeah, go ahead.
How did Massachusetts stand against other states in the country? How bad were they hit? Are they any better off than some of these Western times?
A little bit better off, but not much. But what happened in Massachusetts was the old system of mass employment with shoe factories and textile factories were really, really hard hit, and they were never going to recover. So the unemployment rate in Massachusetts was very high. The rate of bank failures here was just as bad as it was in the rest of the country. So it was very hard hit. But one institution that did fairly well, although not well, but they hung in there, was Filene's. And therein lies a story. Does anybody know how Edward Filene got his name? Their family was the Katz. They came over from Germany in the late 19th century. They were the Katz family, and they wanted to anglicize it. So they became Filene. It's like feline. A lot of people don't know that name. That's what we got, Filene's. And they thought he was crazy when he came up with Filene's Basement. You remember the Filene's Basement contract? You go in there, 25% off, and then 12 more days, another 25% off. Everyone knows Filene's Basement. And they thought he was nuts. He lost money. He lost money for 10 years on Filene's Basement. But during the Depression, if you had any money, if you've gone to shop anywhere, it's going to be Filene's Basement for a lot of people. And Filene's didn't lose as much money as other department stores did, because that Filene's Basement really cemented a kind of loyalty between customer and store, because they had that contract. We know that in 12 days it's going to go down another 20 or 25. So do I buy it now? maybe somebody else will buy it in the meantime, or do I wait? And people never forgot that. People liked it. So Filene's was one of the few institutions that didn't do so bad during the Great Depression, but a lot of others did. A lot of policemen had their, firemen had their pay cut, teachers had their pay cuts. Often what they did with teachers is they would technically cut the pay, but what they would say is, we'll pay you the same amount, but we require a donation. So you have to give money back. So technically you were getting paid less, of course, but they depicted it as a donation so they could restore the pay later on and be a lot more easy bureaucratically if they kept depicting all these less pay that teachers were getting as donations rather than a real pay cut. We see that in a lot of places.
He was one of the things they did. My father worked there. He did not lose his job during the Depression.
At AT&T?
Yeah.
Telephones.
Yeah.
So they were one of the ones that survived.
Mm-hmm. And AT&T would not only survive, but they would do really, really well after the war, because after the war, people are going to be moving around the country. They're not going to be living at home where they had always lived. People got used to moving around during the war. And what do you need to do if you're going to move 300 miles away? You need to call long distance. And so you needed better long distance. So what AT&T was able to do after the war was take the money they made, invest it, and they would figure out what we would eventually call transistors. So they invented the transistor after the war, which meant better long distance service would eventually give us the computer age. That's right.
When was the policeman's strike in Boston?
1919. Yeah. When's the policeman's strike?
They
Boston.
Fired everybody.
Yeah, they made hardly any money, those poor policemen. Yeah, but
how long did that go on?
It went on for about 10 days, I think, something like that.
Did the crime rate?
Yes. Well, what happened was little petty crimes. There are petty crimes around Boston.
Street crime.
But Calvin Coolidge called it the militia, and then occupied Boston with a militia. And which
they fired all the policemen.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
And so some of them came back.
Yeah.
But yeah. Anybody else? Yeah. Go ahead.
I can recall the fact during the Depression, I was only young stuff, but I don't even recall any buildings being built in Boston at all.
Oh, that's probably true. Yeah.
The construction business. And, he was out. Pretty near the whole Depression, you know.
Yeah.
And things were tough. I can remember the bread lines. People like Morgan Memorial or something, they would rent a little area in the city and give out coffee and donuts. And probably more religious groups that would, they'd have to sit there and listen to religious ceremonies, you know.
Right. Yeah.
Get a cup of coffee or a piece of sandwich. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I can remember them very vividly. And it was probably only about 10 or 12 years old at the time.
And people used to go to diners and.
And it leaves a lasting impression on you, you know.
Yeah, when the only meal you have might be going to a diner and getting some hot water and putting some ketchup in, right. Calling that tomato soup, and that's your meal. Yeah. Yeah.
I worked for Boston Public Library, and some of the old timers said that libraries were packed because it was free. You could come in all day, you could get books out, and the children's library, the story hours, they had kids lined up. It was free, and it was warm.
And warm, especially.
So they would,
yeah.
You know, circulate.